sign that man did not give me to me right here in the arm.
Made us, the one that loved us, the one that died for us. Hallelujah. And so let's just go ahead and make much of Jesus tonight.
warmth in the winter, flowers in spring, the laughter of summer, and the changing of leaves. There's food on my table, a good place to sleep, clothes on my back, and shoes on my feet. Oh, how I've been.
Yeah. Operation of God, who hath raised him
from the dead, and you, being dead in your sins and uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. We're talking about the cross and the work of the cross here tonight. And I want to say I'm thankful for the old rugged cross. I'm thankful that that cross still beckons men, women, boys, and girls to come. I'm glad that whosoever will can still come. I'm glad that it does not matter where you came from, what your heritage is, what your background is, what color you are, what your socioeconomic status is. I'm glad, praise be to God, there's a Savior that loves you. There's a Savior that died for you. There's a Savior that will take you just like you are. Amen. I want to talk tonight just for a few moments about this idea. Some things that I left at the cross. The Bible tells us there that there was some ordinances that were against us. It says that those were taken away and that he done that by nailing those to his cross. And I began to think about there's some things in my life that when I got John 3:3 born again, when I got redeemed, when I was saved, they sang about it. Seth, you've done a good job. Amen. They sang about being saved. Amen. When I got saved, I left a few things at the cross. Number one, I left self at the cross. Verse 11 said, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in putting off the body of the sins of the flesh. So we find out that when we go to Calvary, we can know that we can leave ourself behind. See, myself is not a very good self. I've tried to pretty up self. I've tried to fancy up self. I've tried to do everything I could with self. But I have a whole lot of problems with self. I shave him in the morning. I look at him in the mirror. But I know him. And you know self. And self in and of himself is no good. I've tried to reform him. I tried to make him do good. I tried to make him do right. But he just won't. I'm glad, praise be to God, I can leave self behind at Calvary. See, there's something living on the inside of me that's greater than what's on the outside of me. There's somebody that lives inside of me. The Bible said, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. I'm glad to tell you, there's a God living on the inside when you get good and born again. When God changes your life, when God washes you in the blood, there's somebody that moves in to the inside of you and helps you deal with the outside of you. I'm not just talking about shaving, and I'm not talking about your bunion and your corn and all that stuff, man. We're not here to talk about all that nastiness. But what we are here to talk about is this. There's a God that loves you so much that he seen you just like you were and said they can't do it. There's no way they can make this on their own. They've tried. They're doing their best. But the Bible said all of our righteousness is as filthy rags. The very best we can do is a filthy rag before the eyes of God. But I'm glad when I went to the cross. For me it was April 2nd, 1989. I was on my way home from church. I did not get saved in the altar church. I didn't get saved at a mourner's bench. I didn't get saved in the preacher's office. I got saved down at the bruiser's turnaround. God reached down and turned my life around. I couldn't go home until God changed me. But when I got to the cross, I found out what I've been trying to deal with, what I've been trying to do for myself, I could not do. And there was a God that would do what I could not do. I left self behind. Let me tell you what Paul may have been alluding to here. Paul wrote the book of Colossians. Paul also wrote the book of Romans. In the book of Romans, he wrote this, "Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" There was a custom in ancient times that if someone was found guilty of certain crimes, murder especially, but certain crimes that they were found guilty of, they would take the body, a dead corpse, and they would attach that body to this person. As soon as the gavel fell, as soon as guilty verdict had been reached, they would walk out with this now rotten, stinking, putrid body that's on their back. And they're walking around with this on them. Everybody that sees them knows that they're guilty. Everybody that sees them knows that there's something that has happened in their life. Paul said, "Who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" Here in the book of Colossians, he said, "Putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ." What he's saying is, you're right, you're guilty, you deserve it. Everything that you said and everything that came on the account has all come to pass, and it's all on you. But you don't have, hallelujah, but you don't have to live that way. Hey, I'm glad I don't have to walk around with the old man strapped to my back. I don't have to walk around with death on my trail. I don't have to walk around with the nastiness of who I was on me. I can put off old self. I left some things at the cross. I left myself at the cross. I left sin at the cross. Verse 13, "And you, being dead in your sins, and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses." Everything that was on my account. Teenagers, listen. I think it was the 20th of July. I know it was, because the next day was my birthday. And 10 of these got born again. And what a birthday present for a pastor to see young men and young women coming to know Christ. But I don't know what you did. I don't know what it was on your account. But God knows. And some of your accounts, like mine, were pretty tall. You had all sorts of things that you was getting on. Mom and Daddy didn't know, did they? The preacher didn't know. The teachers didn't know. But God knew. God knew everything that you was up against. Let me just pause right now and just preach it to the teenagers.
Come on.
Mom, Papa, Mom, Dad, we're here tonight, and it's so easy for us to say, "Yeah, you know, that's cute. That is real sweet that they're getting baptized." It's not about being cute. It's not about being sweet. It's about the fact that we were guilty and on our way to hell. And if we got what we deserve, that's where we'd be tonight. But Jesus, hallelujah, but Jesus stood in the way. But Jesus beckoned all that would come to come to him. And some have come. Some have called. And praise be to God. They don't have to deal with that anymore. They don't have to live with that anymore. They've been washed. Every bit of it has been taken away. The Bible said cast as far as the east is from the west. I've said it before, but I'll say it again. I believe the reason why the Bible says that is because if you start traveling north,
Before long, you'll go over the polar cap and you'll be heading south. But if you start traveling east, you'll never ever start traveling west. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far our sins have been removed. Somebody removed. I left myself at the cross. I left sin at the cross. And finally, I left my shame. Amen. At the cross. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. There were laws. There were rules that we had to keep, and no one was able to keep those laws. In fact, if you and I were to start from the time that God began to convict our heart, there's a time between when you get born and when you get born again that God looks at you as innocent until He brings you to know that you must be born again. There's children that have yet to come to the age to know that they must be born again. But there comes a time. We're not baptizing no babies tonight. We believe in a believer's baptism. We believe that you must be born again. Then you can follow the Lord in baptism. There's got to come a time and place in your life that you know you're dying on your way to hell, and you call out to God and you ask Him to rescue you, and with everything that's in you, you cling to that cross. You hold on to that blood. You beg God to come down and wash you and clean you up.
Amen.
But from the time we were young until now, if you and I were to start broadcasting everything that we did, every time that we rebelled against Him, every time that we shunned Him, every time that we went contrary to His word, every time we acted in a way we shouldn't have, every time we looked at what we shouldn't have, every time we done what we shouldn't have, it would be a shameful experience tonight. But I'm thankful that, I wish I could sing, He knew me, yet He loved me. When He was on the cross, I was on His mind. He saw everything that I would be. He saw everything that I was. But the Bible said in Romans 5 and verse number 8, but God commendeth His love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He knew what He was getting when He got you, honey. He knew He was getting living. He knew you'd break down. He knew you'd be messed up. But He loved you anyway. Somebody ought to give Him some praise, because He's honored. You left behind your sin. Stand up with me. I'm done. She's got to be out. I want to do this. If you're going to get baptized tonight, maybe it'd be a good time for you to just come around this altar and say, thank you, Jesus, that you had saved somebody like me. Thank you, God, that you washed me in your blood. Tonight, even if you're not getting baptized, you're saved, you know God has changed your life. I wonder how many that know Jesus tonight would just come and find a place and say, God, Lord, thank you for loving me in spite of me. For loving me because I know me. Lord, I want to tell you, I love you. I bless you. I thank you for loving me, for saving me, for washing me. for cleansing me. Lord, I want to tell you I love you tonight. While many are praying, you're here tonight and say, "Preacher, I know that I'm saved. I know that I'm saved. But preacher, I'm not where I need to be with the Lord. With heads bowed and eyes closed. I wonder if you could just slip your hand up tonight. Preacher, would you help me pray? I know I'm saved, but I'm not where I need to be." How many of us slip our hand up there right now? "Preacher, pray for me. Preacher, tonight God's speaking to my heart. I need Jesus inside of me. I need Christ in my heart. I can't do this. I've been fighting it. I've been trying, but I can't. With heads bowed and eyes closed. Preacher, I need Jesus. I need that blood on my life." I wonder how many of us throw our hand up. "Preacher, would you pray for me? I won't come to you. I won't call you out. I won't embarrass you. Wait, just put your hand up and right back down. Preacher, pray for me. Thank you. Preacher, I need Jesus in my heart. I need Jesus in my life tonight. Somebody else, preacher, would you pray for me? Preacher, I need Christ. I don't want to die and go to hell. I don't want Jesus to come back and be left behind. Preacher, please pray. If there's somebody like that tonight, with heads bowed and eyes closed, some raised your hand. Maybe you're here tonight. God's dealing with your heart. Maybe you didn't raise your hand, but God knows your heart. I'll ask you this with heads bowed and eyes closed. You're here tonight, say, "Preacher, I heard what you said about Jesus and about the gospel and how Jesus would accept me like I am. If Jesus would take me like I am, oh, I'd sure take him just as he is." With heads bowed and eyes closed, I want you to pray a prayer like this. The words I speak will do not one thing for you. However, if you pray a prayer like this in your heart, and you mean it, God will hear your prayer. God will save you if you'll ask him. "Dear Jesus, forgive me. I'm a sinner. I failed you. I've messed up. I've done wrong. I know I need you. Please come into my heart right now. Change my life. Save me. Wash me. Make me clean. Take away my shame. Take away that old self that I've been carrying around." With heads bowed and eyes closed, if you prayed a prayer like that and you meant it in your heart, I want you to just slip your hand up and write that down. "Preacher, I ask the Lord in my heart tonight. I ask Jesus to save me." Anybody like that? "Preacher, I ask the Lord to save me right here tonight. Here's my hand." Father, in Jesus' name, we've done all that you've asked. Lord, I pray that you touch every heart, every life in this place. Lord, meet with us in this hour through this celebration of what you've done in life, the lives of others. Have your will, have your way. We'll thank you and bless you. We ask in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. While you remain standing, if you're going to be baptized, you can go ahead and go get prepared. You need to meet me down at the very back here, going up to the steps. You can go get prepared. And they're going to come around. I tell you what, here'd be a good time. Let's get our musicians up here. We're going to play a little bit. If you need to go get you something to drink, run to the restroom real quick, you can do that. And they're going to start singing here in just a little bit. And we'll move right on in the service. All right? Thank you.
Gave his life free to me. everybody see what God's doing on the inside of me. Because you profess your faith in Him, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Amen.
Washed in the blood.
Luke, because you don't profess your faith in him, I baptize you, my brother.
Thank you. me paid the price.
So that these could go. And
as he was saying, it's wonderful to have a nice building and all that stuff. But when you invest into souls, you're investing into eternity. Let's remember, it's not about this. It's about people. And it's about us reaching people for the cause of Christ. Thank you for giving. Thank you for giving so that we could go. Thank you for praying. Thank you for believing. God did some wonderful things. I want to say this, and it's probably embarrassing, but I want to say to my wife, thank you for your faith. Ephesians 3:20 on the refrigerator. Every time you go, there was that big old list of teenagers and all that would come along with that, with the cost and everything else. Sometimes it's easy to look at the mountain and think that's awful big and not remember there's a God that made that mountain. There's a God that can. And I say, thank God. If you got baptized tonight, y'all stand back there so they can shake your hand on your way out. Gage, get back there. Whoever else is there, walk and stand back there. And they're going to shake your hand. Did we take up an offering? We didn't do that. All right, let's just take care of that on the way out. When you give, it helps us to be able to continue ministries like this and to be able to be a blessing. And how many of you are thankful to see people in the baptistry? I had a conversation not long ago with a trusted friend. And one of the things that was, I was sharing a burden in my heart, and it was that I had never been able to see people in the baptistry in a long time. But like, that might not bother you, but it bothers me.
Yeah.
It bothers me real bad. And today, it was wonderful being, but for this preacher, it was a shot in the arm. Thank God he's still saving.
Amen.
For all sinners, amen. Y'all stand up. Let's pray and we'll be dismissed. We appreciate all of you coming. It's an honor to have you worshiping with us. And we're praising the Lord for what he's going to do and believing God for great things. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for who you are. Thank you that you're God.